Imagine you are giving a conference presentation and are so nervous you are trembling. As you begin, the AV equipment fails. Even worse, the big name scientist whose work you are about to refute walks in and sits in the front row. A nightmare, right? That happened to me in one of my first conference talks. Hi, I'm Karen McKee. In this video, I'll share with you some of the presentation skills I developed over the years that helped me give great talks and to deal with such unexpected situations. A successful presentation depends not only on delivery skills, but also on careful preparation and a solid design. Let's begin with preparation. There are two important questions to keep in mind when preparing any talk, and you should ponder them right from the start. The first is, what is your central point, the core message you want to get across? This may seem obvious, but it's surprising how many presentations you will hear that do not answer this basic question. The second is, why does your message matter to the audience? This may also seem obvious, but some speakers find it difficult to answer. This is the beginning of putting yourself into your audience's shoes. They're thinking, so what? And if you don't answer that unspoken question, they may conclude that your information is not important. With the answers to those questions in mind, the next step is to sketch out your talk. It helps to get away from your computer and use post-it notes, a whiteboard, or a notepad to outline your talk. A traditional format starts with a brief background, followed by the objectives or questions, methods, results, and ends with the conclusions. The background should concisely set the stage for your talk, keeping in mind that you want to say just enough to orient the audience to your topic and to grab their attention. Next, list one or two objectives or questions. You likely won't have time for more, so select your most important question or questions. You also want to keep the methods description as short as possible, focusing on experimental design, study location, and major variables measured. Next, describe your results, limiting these to the main findings that address your stated objectives or questions. End with conclusions, which put your work into a broader perspective. How does your study move the field forward, resolve a conflict in the literature, or suggest a practical application? In other words, why should your audience care about your findings? For each of these main sections, you will plan one or more slides. How many slides and how much detail will depend on the talk. For a conference talk in which you have 15 minutes, we'll allow for a few slides, whereas an hour seminar can encompass more detail and more slides. Now let's talk a bit about design as you sit down at your computer and begin to prepare your slides. Whether you use PowerPoint, Keynote, or Prezi, you want to follow the same guidelines. One of the most important concepts to understand in designing a presentation is to avoid a Frankenstein mixture of document and presentation. You should strive to create a real presentation that is only understandable with you present to deliver it, not a text-heavy series of slides as you see here. The problem with such a slide is that the audience can read faster than you can speak. Instead of listening to you, they are reading. You are probably reading the text on the screen instead of listening to me. A better option is to list a word or two for each item so that the audience looks to you to explain each one. Even better is to animate the list so that each item is highlighted in turn and the text fades out. Here is the best way to do it. Use illustrations to indicate your points. You can show them all at once, or animate them to appear one at a time. Photographs, graphs, and diagrams provide a visual image that helps the audience understand and remember your points. At the same time, they serve as reminders for you without being obvious about it. If you are speaking to an international audience, it's okay to include text titles as shown here to help people who aren't native speakers of your language. People react emotionally to images, which means they tend to remember information longer than if presented as text. Take the time to build a good library of images from your work. I spent hours in the field taking photographs that I used to illustrate my presentations. Images can be an efficient way to compare and contrast information. The rule of thirds provides a simple guideline for composing photographs. This grid divides the slide into thirds, and where the lines cross are called power positions. Images composed according to the rule of thirds are usually more aesthetically pleasing. Here's another example. In this image, the subject is framed in the left third instead of centered, and the foreground occupies the lower two thirds with sky in the upper third. Another concept to keep in mind in designing your slides is the signal-to-noise ratio. Sometimes we try to make our slides more interesting by having lots of colors, 3D, or a background photograph, but this increases the noise to signal. This slide is an exaggeration, but it makes the point that you should only include elements that help with understanding the slide. Here is the same information presented in a clean, simple style. The photo in this case shows the species being examined but does not add noise to the slide. The whole point here is to minimize the clutter and to include only those elements necessary to get the audience to focus in on the key result. Here is an example in which the focus is on a single number, 65% reduction in fish size in commercial landings. And I included a visual that drives home the message. And of course, the image is aesthetically pleasing because I've used the rule of thirds to compose it. Another skill to develop is how to create good illustrations. There will be many instances in which a photograph does not work and you need a diagram of something, but you don't need a fancy graphics or illustration program. I made this drawing of a cell in PowerPoint using just two of the drawing functions. All of your careful preparation and attention to design will be for naught if you cannot deliver the information within your time limit and in a compelling manner. A good rule of thumb is to calculate how many words you can speak based on your speaking rate and the time you have been given. If you speak at 150 words per minute and wish to speak for 12 minutes, leaving 3 for questions, then the text of your talk should be no longer than 1,800 words. Then you must practice your talk out loud. You may think that people who are excellent speakers don't practice, that they just get up and wing it. That is rarely true. Musicians don't perform without intensive practice beforehand, and neither should you. If possible, practice in front of other people and get feedback. Video yourself and then identify what needs to be improved. Also, if you have practiced, you will have more confidence. Know what you want to say in general terms, but don't memorize exactly how to say it. Doing so minimizes the chances of blanking out and helps you sound more natural. You must try to connect with your audience. Always face forward. If you spend most of your time looking back at your slides, you will have your back to your audience. Not only will you fail to connect, but people can sneak out when your back is turned. The audience must be able to see you and your body language, especially your face. Gesturing to make a point helps tell the audience that you are engaged with them, but also does a number of other things. It makes you look more confident and authoritative because you are comfortable claiming your space. If you scrunch up behind the lectern, you send the message that you are not confident and perhaps are trying to make yourself a smaller target in case the audience begins throwing rotten fruit. Your voice is also important. High, squeaky voices sound weak, whereas lower voices sound more authoritative. Avoid distracting behaviors such as rocking back and forth, wringing your hands, playing with the remote control, and other self-soothing actions. I don't recommend using a laser pointer unless you can hold the laser point rock steady. Use animated arrows or other means to highlight a data point. Finally, let's talk about how to handle the question and answer period. First, be sure you understand each question and ask for clarification if you don't. If you don't know the answer, say, "I don't have that information right now, but here's what I do know." Then pivot to something related that you are familiar with. Or offer to follow up with the questioner later after you've researched the question. Many questions can be anticipated, so spend some time thinking about how you would answer them before your talk. Now, you may get an aggressive question or a rambling question that is hard to follow. Don't respond with anger or sarcasm. Remain calm, poised, and respectful, no matter how your questioner is behaving. Restate negative or incoherent questions so that they are clear and without emotion. The audience will respect you for it. Besides aggressive questions, you also need to be prepared for other things to go wrong, as I described earlier. I began this video with a story about a potentially disastrous experience at the beginning of my career. When the projector failed, I went ahead with my talk without my slides. I was able to do so because I had practiced and knew my material. Fortunately, the projector was fixed about 3 minutes later, and I was able to resume showing my slides. The big-name scientist I had been so afraid of came up to me later at the break to tell me how much he enjoyed my talk, and we had a great discussion about the differences in our research findings. In the end, there are a lot of ways you can improve your chances of succeeding in science, but learning how to communicate a compelling message in person is by far one of the best. Dare to exceed expectations and stand out from the crowd. Who knows what you might accomplish? Thanks for watching, and please like my video if you found it helpful.